Welcome to everybody on my YouTube channel again, and as you see here, now again in my electronic lab, because I have to fix this Casio CZ-1 synthesizer, which has a really common issue with the battery and or with the memory backup. I don't think so it's a really big deal or a very big complicated repairman, but if you like to watch opening and some kind of review from me or some kind of teardown from me, this is the best time for Casio CZ-1. So let's jump now into the title, because I find a very nice service manual for the Casio CZ-1, and on one page I find this battery and the whole circuit for the power of the detector and for the reset circuits, and this circuit is contain the battery, because when you switch off your synth, this small battery here has to be power all the memory chips which is inside in the Casio CZ-1 synthesizer. But the Casio, I think they did some kind of mistake or not mistake. They planned to use a normal Panasonic BR2032 battery, which is not rechargeable, but in the circuits they did some kind of charging, like tiny charging. So let's check back now how it's going. So when I switch it off, the charge from the battery, it can go through this resistor and through this diode, because now the potential on two sides of the diode, it's around 3 volts. So the current really can flow to this direction. But what's happened when all this circuit is switched back and the VBL line has some kind of voltage on it? So here you see there is one transistor which is switching back the voltage to the memory power bus, but from this power bus, don't forget, here you have 3 volt, and here you have some kind of I don't know, like 5 volt, or I will measure it. Your battery is around 3.1, 3.2 volt, and some kind of really tiny current can flow across this resistor back to the battery. But this is the trap. I think the Casio is planned this for rechargeable batteries, but then after they put inside the normal BR battery, which is not rechargeable. So I think this is why slowly in every Casio CZ-1 synthesizer always these batteries get wrong, because even if you charge with a really tiny potential, your non-rechargeable battery, it will be die slowly. So anyway, the Panasonic invented this battery on the 1970s or 1980s, I don't remember, and they said this battery can store around 200 milliampere hour of capacity. But very interesting things with this Panasonic BR type batteries, it can hold the 3 volt voltage for very long time. It's they wrote it as around 1000 hour or something like this on a normal discharge using, and so that's it. So it's meaning, if you replace your battery in your Casio CZ-1 to normal BR battery, you will get around normally without charging back, because this circuit is do some kind of charging back, you will get around 600-700 hour long power to keep your memory settings. But with this very tiny charging, it slowly start to drop down by day. So it's meaning every 3-4 year you have to replace this battery. Unfortunately, now I don't have any rechargeable coin type battery like this, but for my other experiments I have a bunch from this Panasonic BR 2032, which is looks like this, and in my package I get 60 pieces for I don't know for $6 or something from the eBay. So this is the original Panasonic BR 2032 battery, and I already prepared one for my other experiments. I just simply take it off the this isolation from around, and I just cut it down the legs, because I don't know how it's actually implanted into this Casio CZ-1, because I never opened this synth. So let me show you what was the problem with this synth. Okay, so here is the closer look of the LCD of the Casio CZ-1 synthesizer. And I believe this is some kind of really common problem with those kind of old synthesizers, because now you will see when I turn it on. So let's see. So when I turn it on, it looks everything normal. But the problem is this synth in the last minute when I used, I'm not used in a tone mix mode. And also my last tone mix setup is not like this. So let's jump now to the normal one tone operation, which is look, wow, ooh, what I get, like it's really is not good. So let's jump now between the patches. And as you see, I lose all of my patches, and everywhere just really just garbage. And believe me, you don't wanna hear what is coming out on the output of this synth. So it's just really garbage. As how it looks on the LCD is exactly same what you get on a sound output. So let's now open this synth and try to find the problem, but I think it's really simple problem. It's the issue of the battery. So how I know this is some kind of battery issue? Because if I switch off the synth and I press the initialize button plus I turn it on, then the system will ask me, do you want to initialize the synthesizer? It's meaning it will be reload all the factory default sounds. So now you see I get back everything. So yeah, I lose my all of my own patches, but it's nothing fancy going on in my personal patches, because I always use the on a Casio since the original patches, which was it's really easy way to get some really good sounds from it. So yeah, now I get back the original factory sound, but let's see what will happen if I turn it off and I turn it back. Do you see already? We start to lose some kind of data, but not it's really weird. It's like somebody mixing up the 8-bit lines in a processor or in a memory. So yeah, it's definitely something wrong with the memory or with the memory or with the battery. So let's now open the synth. Okay, so here is the synth, and I want to show you guys where you have to unscrew these screws. You see this metal, it's under the keyboard, and this you have to unscrew. So 1, 2, 3, 4 piece of screw. So let me prepare here some kind of box for the screws. By the way, I'm always using some kind of this small case, because inside I can put this kind of separator, and then I can collect from screws from outside the top, inside, blah blah blah. And if I have more type of screws, which is really common in all the kind of gear, because on that time they don't put too much effort on a planning to use the one or maximum two different size of screw. So this is really helpful. Or maybe if you just have match boxes, just simply write on it V screw to get from where. Now you have to unscrew this one, and those big, which is hold the whole keyboard, and these screws here, and all this. So mainly almost all the screws you have to remove it. Okay, and on the front you have to open this one, this which is I don't have it's just glossy. So this one here in this corner, please not unscrew, because it's just hold the common ground from the power supply. So this you don't have to unscrew it at all. Here you have four other screws, 1, 2, and 2 here. So this you also have to open it. Okay, and if we are lucky, ta-da, we can open the whole synth. Here is the Casio CZ-1 inside. It's a plenty lot of stuff is going on here. And now we have to take out the keyboard, because the battery is somewhere here under the keyboard in a very, very, very difficult reaching place. So for that I have to undo this ribbon cable, and somewhere here, if I can find it, somewhere here, yeah, I just have to remove this ribbon cable. And this cable, it's actually the aftertouch sensor cable, and this spot here, this is where you can adjust the sensitivity of the aftertouch. So now I don't touch this aftertouch, but I undo the cable. So let's remove this cable also. Okay, so now we will take out the whole keyboard, but I find it's maybe I have better results if I also remove this side panel. So let's simply just unscrew it. I removed this side panel, and now I simply can lift out the whole keyboard. Which is very nice and big chunk of panels on it. I think it's nothing fancy going on that. By the way, here is here is the aftertouch sensor which is missing from the Casio CZ-5000, and basically this whole line is going long under the keyboard, and when you press the keyboard, you see here, maybe, yeah, when you press the keyboard, this part of this plastic is make a pressure on this sensor, and this is how the whole keyboard is react on aftertouch. So let's put this to the side. Okay. Okay. Now I get it why I have this issue with the memory. Because somebody in the past, I think maybe the previous owner, he put inside a normal CR, maybe you cannot see, but it's a normal C2025 coin battery, which is really tiny and really sleepy. And let's measure it, what's going on with this battery. And let's measure it if contain any voltage. No, it's useless, it's like 0.1 volt. So let's now take my Panasonic BR, beautiful, 3.4 volt. On the service manual, you see here some kind of test jumper, and I think this one is that. This is the place where you can attach your current measurement, so make sure when your synth is switched off, it's not consuming more current which is originally planned. Okay, so here is my modified Panasonic BR, because I don't think so this is looks to me original. I think somebody did here the replacement from the original, because in that age, in the 80s or in the 90s, this kind of battery holder is simply not exist. And I think somebody installed here this holder, but let's check if he did a good job. So this is the negative, has to be ground, okay, and the positive, like around, okay, it's like connected to some kind of capacitor, sorry. So let's now install the battery. Sorry guys, I really don't have what to do here. It's, I told you, it's like a really simple repairment. So now I have here 3.2 volt, which is actually is dropping really drastically. So let's measure now the current, because this will be the key. Yeah, I know you will measure the current. Okay, let's measure the DC current. And this point, which is going to the memory chips. So I have here 0.2 milliampere, which is nothing. So I don't have any really big current flowing into the memory chip, so I don't have memory error, I think. So let's plug it back and do again a measurement on the voltage. It's actually It's dropping, but I think because these batteries, it's from the factory, they are coming with 3.4 volt, but of course this 3.4 volt is not the voltage level of these batteries. And the Panasonic said this battery can hold the 3 volt for 1000 hour long. So let's now switch back the synth, because I want to show you guys how this kind of charging it's operating. So if I'm right, with this diode here, we have to get back some kind of really tiny current which is flowing to this direction, back to the battery. So okay, let's check now the voltages here on my new replaced the battery, because as you saw before, it's dropping to 3 volt soon when it's switched off, which is total normal from the Panasonic battery. But now if I measure this leg here, as you see, we have a really tiny bit of charging. And if I disconnect now the battery, all this point which is before the diode, now it's on 4.8 volt, and I discharged this capacitor, and let's see what's going on after this diode. You see that tiny charging up? So let's now wait until we have some kind of really big voltage. You see? It's growing. So it's meaning this non-chargeable battery slowly get killed, because this voltage is floating from the closed diode back to the battery. You see, now it's 3.33. Now it will be growing up more, you see? So this is the issue why the Casio CZ-1 is killing slowly the normal non-chargeable battery. So let's now measure the current, how much current is floating from this circuit back to the battery. This is the current which is floating from the diode to the battery. It's not a huge current, but slowly can kill your battery. So definitely, if you are replacing this battery, or you do some kind of solution like this previous owner did here, make sure you get a rechargeable battery, because Casio, I think they did a small mistake here. So now let's do some kind of really small teardown kind of video, because if we are open it already, I just want to show you guys what we can find inside in this synth. I don't think so too much going on here. This is the main power unit, and as you see, it has a really big chunk of transformer and a really well designed filter from the main lines, which is sitting on that panel, completely isolated from any other PCB. This PCB, it's mainly only contain the normal voltage regulation solutions and fuses and capacitors. And this part of the panel, here you can find the some kind of sub CPU, which is the beautiful double-lined CPU from the old ages, and this is only doing the driving of the LEDs and the switches. There is some kind of app ROM, and the main CPU is actually that which is the same like this, but of course with a different software on it. But all the magic is happening here. And why I say it's magic? Because the Casio CZ-1 has a really, really unique sound and really deep dynamics, and it has a really, really unique sound. So let's now do some kind of back research. Why is it? The Casio in that time, they used 12-bit digital to analog converter, but if you listen carefully the sound of the Casio CZ-1, you cannot believe this is a 12-bit digital to analog converter sound. Why? Because the Casio used two pieces of, they called music LSI. The main CPU is just sending the data and the calculation commands to these two CPU, and they are working like this. So when one is doing something, the other is not doing nothing. This is the operation on a tone mix mode, but in a single tone mode, also these two working on a same sound. So how all this solution with a 12-bit digital to analog converter can get this kind of really high dynamics on a bass and on a lush synthesized sounds? The trick is really unique, because you remember on that time they just can use a 12-bit digital to analog converter. So the master LSI music chip, which is, by the way, it's running on 40 kilohertz, so it's already one LSI chip is really on a high sample rate, it's almost the CD quality, but you get two, so it's meaning in each half period this LSI is working on 40 kilohertz and the slave is just doing some kind of dithering compensation, but is a bit delayed from the main LSI music CPU. So, and then after the two digital signal is like mixed together, so the real quantization here, it's around 40 kilohertz, and it's really fine on levels. And this is what is going into the digital to analog converter. But wait a sec. How? This is not a solution for extend the dynamic range. So what the Casio did? They applied a kind of expander into the signal. So here you can see these two LSI processor is generating this kind of signal. But when the dynamic is much more higher than what the 12-bit digital to analog converter can do, they simply just do this jump here and it simply continue the signal, but not in here, because this is the limit what this DAC converter can produce it. So they just simply lower again by mathematics, and they are doing again the missing top part. So this is actually which is coming into the expander circuit. But from the expander circuit, you have to get this signal. So from the expander circuit, you have to get this signal, which is already corrected this kind of trick. So how they are doing it? In a special chip, they choose, it has a three leg where you can switch between the amplification factor of this expander. So it's meaning when this music LSI is detecting higher dynamic what can the digital to analog converter can handle it, it's also send a command to the expander circuit. So let's jump to here, and then this signal from this chip is going up, and this is how the Casio did a much more wider, bigger dynamic range and much more bigger sampling rate from the music chips. I think it's a really unique solution, and this is why the Casio CZ-1 has this really unique sound. So let's now jump a bit forward. Analog board, where you can find a bunch of op-amps and low-pass filters. By the way, they are using a very high quality adjustable low-pass filter, so if you want to do some kind of modification here you can do it. And then after the whole signal is just going to the output panel. So, but now if this synth is already open and I have to do some kind of adjustments on the synth, because in this service manual I get a really nice list what I have to adjust. It's mainly not as much what you can adjust, but you can adjust the digital to analog converter offset voltage, which is really important on the sound. Then you can adjust some kind of op-amp voltages. Then you can adjust the LCD brightness, and you also can adjust the aftertouch sensor, which is a bit complicated, because for that you have to load a specific sound from the sound bank, and on our oscilloscope you have to adjust. But of course I will do it. I don't think so it's a big drama. And you also can adjust, do some kind of adjustment on the VCA offset, which is again very important from the sound wise, because the VCA is controlled by the aftertouch and by the foot pedals. So it really can affect the whole dynamics what you can get from the synth without the pedals. And there is more, not too much adjustments, so I just do now some kind of really quick adjustments. The first easy adjustment here is the first op amp after the digital to analog converter, and in the manual the reading you have to get here on the first leg of the op amp about -3 millivolt. This is one of my favorite millivolt meter, and do a null. Okay, now it's null. Okay, and this is really sensitive unit, because I can go up to the 6.5 digit. So it's meaning I can read really low, really precise values on a millivolt range, but for now it's much more enough for me for up to 10th of millivolt. So let's do a measurement again on this op amp first leg. By the way, this is signed as TL082 first, so -1, and yeah, you see this is almost 10 millivolt, which is too high. So let's continue now to get down 8, 7, 3. No, oh, it's a bit high. Good. Yeah, it's very stable, and now we're on a -3 millivolt. So let's jump now to the next one, which is the VSS1 voltage adjustment, which is the power source for MSM6200. And this voltage adjustment is for this op amp here. And this is how they wrote it. So we have to measure between the fifth leg of the op amp and between the digital ground, and we have to adjust this VR1 until the VSS1, which is that, it will get 2.25. It's a slightly off, so let's adjust this potty until we get 2.25 exactly. It's too much. Okay, here we are. I think it's a very good result. And if you want to adjust the aftertouch in your synth, you can find the potty here behind this first ribbon cable. But for that you have to connect back all the keyboard and all the other stuffs, and you simply just push this to the side, and then you can adjust the aftertouch. But now I don't want to adjust the aftertouch, because I don't have any issue with that. I think already somebody turned it to the maximum, and really this Casio CZ-1 aftertouch has a really nice response for the pressing. So now let's put everything together. So okay, now we put everything together and so let's switch it on and let's see what's going on. of course we get the same results like them before, because if you remember when we installed the battery, we did some kind of plug unplug even when the device is switched off. So now again I get garbage on the memory, but to fix it, it's very simple. When you switch on a back, you have to press this button together. Then the system will ask you to sure you want to initialize the whole system. Yes. Then the system is initialized. So now I get back everything which is the factory default. Okay, and now if we did a good job, if I switch on, wait a bit, if I switch it back, it will come back to the same position what we used last. And let me show you guys something else. So if you have on patches in your Casio CZ-1, first you have to copy and save into this RAM pack RI6. This is how Casio call it. It's actually nothing more, just a tiny bit of memory chip inside and one battery. But to make sure, I also will check the battery inside in this memory card. It's so simple, you just see here 1, 2, 3 screws, and you just have to open it carefully, and you see here inside, oh, again, it's a kind of different battery chip. And so let's measure it, what's going on with this battery. Why you have to replace this also? Because this memory, when you plug in to the back, it's also connecting to the same line of the power what your inside memory is using. But now I find this cell, it's really it's in a good condition, so I don't have to replace it. And by the way, I don't think so this big battery, it will be fit. So for that you have to use the 16 of this cell battery, which is not too high. You see, it's like a really thin battery. So, but of course later on I will replace also these two rechargeable battery, but for the moment it's okay. Okay, but now I want to show you guys also something really interesting with the Casio CZ-1, because I find the chorus effect inside, it's doing a really nice and interesting weird stuffs with the sound. So when you turn this up, you get a maximum of the stereo chorus effect, but somehow in some mixes I realized when I listen with a good quality headphone, this chorus is somehow it's moved the sound in a stereo field, not just make wider, it's also somehow it's lifting in a position. So if you have very high quality monitors or very high quality headphone, you can hear this really unique effect of the Casio CZ-1 chorus. But now, let's have a look what can do this with the sound, because this kind of lifting in a stereo field, which is not on a X axis, it's also in a Y axis, it's always by some kind of phase difference in a very high frequency ranges. It's around 60 or even 80 thousand hertz. So let's check now this, but for that I have to load some kind of sound, of course. I already turned on the math function, which is show you the FFT results, which is now it's starting from 0 Hz to 60 kHz. And okay, you say, well, why we care about the 60 kHz? Because the human ear is just about 20 kHz is end. But no, it's this phenomenon of this Y position lifting from this Casio CZ-1, I can demonstrate to you here by this FFT transformation. So when this stereo chorus is totally off, it's actually is just running, you see, up to it's just running up to the 22 kHz, because now this is the range of the human hearing spectrum. So you see now I have here this cursor, which is showing you the first one is about 30 kHz, and the other one is showing you about 45 kHz. So now this stereo chorus is switched off completely. So let's see, this sound is just up to here. But listen, not listen, look the spectrum if I turn it on. The stereo chorus, some kind of really weird stuff is going on here on a very high frequencies. So let's see it. You see that? Which is running from 35 to 45 kilohertz. And this is what is doing actually this phenomenon. So if I now I just take it off slowly, you see, now I put it back, you see this weird artifact there? This is what is doing for you this Y position lifting, and it's doing some kind of, if you put the headphone on your head, you can hear it's like the sound is coming around your head, and it's somehow is going back to you, and it's doing not just left right, it's also doing some kind of lifting. So I can demonstrate to you again. So this is the tone alone, and now switch on. You see that? It's kind of really weird, and this I really like it. That's all for today. I just simply will put back the Casio CZ-1 into my home recording studio, and I think we did a really short repairment on this battery and memory issue. But if you are interested on a phase distortion synthesis, you have to go to the internet what this kind of synthesis can generate for you. And if you want to do phase distortion synthesis in your songs, I don't believe you can achieve this really unique sound with virtual instruments, because the CZ line is using this kind of really weird sound generation technology. You remember these two sound chip and this dynamic expander solution and this 12-bit digital to analog converter, and then after all these old-fashioned op amps and filters and coil adjusted filters, and also this unique but noisy onboard effect. So if you want to get a proper real phase distortion synthesis with this unique Casio sound, you definitely have to buy something on eBay. Those synths are really running for really cheap on eBay, from $50 to up to maximum $300, depend on the condition. And from the whole CZ line, the CZ-1 is the flagship, because the CZ-1 has the keyboard which is not just velocity sensitive but also aftertouch sensitive. And so yeah, that's it about the CZ-1. I don't want to do now a deep review on how you can modify the sound and how you can do other things on the scene, because there is tons of billions very good videos about it. And I like this synth, because this synth can help me a lot on a bass sounds, on a lead synth sounds, and also on this really weird spacey, lushy carpet kind of synthesized sounds. And so yeah, that's it. If you want to go to the space but you don't have money for pay these tickets for the spaceship private companies, you definitely have to buy some kind of Casio CZ synthesizer. And I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and see you next time. Bye.